We hear a lot about the destruction of forests around the world. From Indonesia, to the jungles of Africa, to the Amazon. Virgin forests are being cut at an incredible rate. An area the size of a football field disappears every second. What we don't hear is what has happened in this country. Since the settlers arrived in 1620, we've cut 95% of our own virgin forests down. The few that remain today stand almost entirely within the boundaries of the national forests. These places of ancient trees, clean air, and clear water were set aside for all of us. They belong as much to someone from Maine, Florida, or California as they do to people out here in the Rockies. And they are among the last places you can go to experience what America was like when the settlers first landed. But something has gone terribly wrong in our national forests. Most people think national forests are protected like national parks. They're not. What's happening here on the Bitterroot is happening throughout the national forest system. Every day, more of our forests are turned into clear cuts.
The current management of our national forests is a national disgrace.
The American people have no idea that they're even cutting in the national forest.
When you come here and see what's been going on, you just want to notify the whole countryside.
I'm madder than hell. And it bothers me when they start tearing up our national heritage.
The U.S. Forest Service is developing, that's a polite word, destroying between 1 and 2 million acres of unprotected wilderness every year. 1.5 million acres a year is about half the size of Connecticut. It's 3/4 the size of Yellowstone National Park. It's larger than Rhode Island. And this is destruction that occurs every single year. There's no excuse for that.
Our mission is really caring for the land and serving people. And I want to be good hosts for the American public and those people that come here. I want them to have a wonderful experience when they come to the Bitterroot National Forest.
As kids, we thought of the Forest Service as Smokey and his familiar message. Only you can prevent forest fires.
Smokey the Bear, Smokey the Bear. Prowling.
And a growl and a sniff in the air.
A variety of experience really is what we're trying to provide for as many people as we possibly can.
Why they call him Smokey?
That was how we got his name.
Smokey the Bear.
Smokey the Bear? It was sort of went hand in hand with the Forest Service as good guys with white hats. It never was intended for that, but it had that side effect. So in a way, the Forest Service is still using Smokey the Bear to sort of maintain its good guy image. When the public sees Smokey the Bear, they get warm, fuzzy feelings, which tends to allow them to give the benefit of the doubt to the Forest Service.
Jeff DeBonis became a ranger, thinking that Smokey the Bear and the Forest Service stood for the same thing. In reality, Smokey only stands for fire prevention, and the Forest Service is involved with a lot more than that.
I started working on the Kootenai National Forest in northwest Montana, and I was introduced to modern industrial forestry, where you went into a very steep slope, you cut off all the trees, i.e. clear cutting, and then you planted your little trees about 8 or 10 feet apart. And I took a look at that. I said, you know, what is wrong with this picture? And I asked them, I said, isn't this a problem? Aren't we going to get soil erosion? And I was told to know on certain terms that, no, this was modern industrial forestry. We knew what we were doing. And any erosion we got was well within the tolerable limits of damage. So I just sat back and watched. We had big floods. We had debris slides. We had damaged fisheries, damaged watersheds, lots of soil erosion. And in my 12 years of experience with the Forest Service, I became increasingly more upset and disappointed with the way that the Forest Service managed our national forests. I had no idea that the Forest Service was dominated by this timber cutting mindset that we later called getting the cutout mindset. They're going to need a lot more than Smokey the Bear to pull them out of the hole this time, in terms of public credibility.
Howie Walk guides trips into the national forests of the Rocky Mountains. This region holds the largest tracts of virgin forest left in the continental United States. When people hear virgin forest, they usually imagine the big trees of the Pacific Northwest. But those forests have been massively overcut, while these in the Rockies remain mostly intact.
These mountains are our last strongholds of wildness. They're our last strongholds of healthy habitat. And it's the last place remaining where we have a chance to protect a bit of what planet Earth used to be.
This is our heritage, what remains of the great American wilderness. Some of these trees took root before the pilgrims landed, but there's a lot more at stake here than just trees. It is the home of plants and animals that have evolved over millions of years, life which thrives only in this complete and healthy ecosystem. From the majestic golden eagle and the grizzly bear, to the bighorn sheep and the mountain lion. It's hard to think of America without them. But as this habitat is destroyed, their numbers will become smaller and smaller. The national forests of the Rocky Mountains are some of the last complete ecosystems left on Earth. Like living blueprints, they offer us a glimpse of how nature's design was intended to work. And they are the best place we have to preserve the diversity of life that evolved on this continent. This is crucial to the health of our planet. What took nature millions of years to evolve can be destroyed in a matter of hours. Clear cutting is a harvesting technique that has a devastating effect on everything that lives in the forest. After the trees are hauled away, the leftover slash is burned, which kills the wealth of life beneath the soil, the insects and microbes that are the very foundation of the forest ecosystem. Larger animals, like grizzly bears, need undisturbed habitat for their survival. Clear cutting disrupts that habitat and pushes this already threatened species even closer to extinction. In the Rockies, most of the forests grow on steep slopes where the soil is thin. When the trees are cut, there is nothing to hold the soil in place, and it is washed away by the rain. This soil was formed over thousands of years. It's difficult for a new forest to grow back once it is gone. When this irreplaceable topsoil is washed downhill, it ends up in streams and rivers, clogging them with silt. The silt smothers the eggs of salmon and trout. Entire populations can be wiped out in a single season. Most troubling of all, clear-cutting threatens something none of us can do without.
No, we wouldn't have anything here to speak of. Probably support one cow at the very most, this whole piece up here, if we didn't have water for it. There was an area near our home that they had clear cut, just a small patch of it, within sight of a picture window of ours. And I began to study it and see what had been done. We noticed the difference in our water supply. In checking, we discovered a third of our watershed was involved, was bare.
This whole continuous running battle we're having with the Forest Service, and in a sense with Congress, motivated by the timber packs, is really a tragic and ironic twist on what originally was a very, very different scenario. Lyle Watts, who was chief of the U.S. Forest Service in 1947, said, "Continued denudation of the watersheds will increase runoff at the wrong time, increase soil erosion, impact streams, reduce or at least not increase needed water yield in late summer, and where critical watershed values are involved, other uses must be restricted to the extent necessary to protect these watershed values." Now, what's happened? Well, instead of becoming the stewards of the national forests, we find that the Forest Service is desecrating our forested watersheds, and in so doing, is turning this country into a sort of a desert. India, China, almost any country of old civilization and temperate to semi-arid climate is now an example of a desert that was once a lush and green place. From the gardens of Babylon and the cedars of Lebanon and the magnificent forests that surrounded the Mediterranean that the Greeks, the Phoenicians, and everybody else laid to waste, they're all deserts now, where once they were lush and beautiful places.
I keep coming back to the old basic of water, and I think that's the first thing that should be protected. You can get by without hot dogs, you can get by without Caesar salad, but can you get by without drinking water?
Over 2,000 years ago, the philosopher Plato observed that cutting the trees on the hills above Athens caused the land to dry up, destroying the city's water supply. A third of the water we use in this country originates in the national forests. We cannot afford to ignore history.
The Forest Service today, I think, is absolutely committed to being a good steward of the land. We are celebrating our 100th birthday this year, too. And all the way through the centennial celebration, we've talked about celebrating conservation as an idea. And that was the basis under which the National Forest System was established.
In the days of the pioneers, forests of ancient trees blanketed this continent in such profusion that all believed they were inexhaustible. We continue to treat them as such through the coming of the industrial age and the exploding demand for fuel, housing, railroads, and pulp for paper. In the rush to satisfy the insatiable need for wood, timber barons saw only the trees and cared little for perpetuating forests. Cut out and get out was their philosophy, and it left a devastating array of consequences in its wake. Communities that had boomed while the forest was being leveled, busted as the last tree fell, leaving graveyards of stumps, rusting machinery, and broken dreams behind. Hillsides stripped of forest cover and unable to regulate the flow of water, dumped floods on helpless towns in the spring and dried to parched desert wastelands in the summer. A generation ago, worried leaders realized that only government intervention could stem the rising tide of forest destruction. They found in President Theodore Roosevelt an ally who, in a bold and foresighted move, signed a bill creating the National Forests, vast tracts of pristine land to be held in trust for the American people by the United States Forest Service. Under the keen eyes of an army of rangers, all the vital benefits of the national forests are protected. Scenic beauty and the recreational opportunities it affords, wildlife habitat and watersheds with the vital fisheries they hold in their clear waters. When timber can be spared, it is cut in strict accordance with the principles of sustained yield logging. Sustained yield means that only the most mature trees are taken. Many are left for future harvest, and the forest cover is always maintained. Sustained yield means that our forests, in all their splendor, will remain for all time, not only for the benefit of today, but for the generations of Americans yet to walk among these trees.
The Forest Service was created with an environmental mandate that has been grossly contradicted in its behavior over the last 20 years. I'm certain that the vast majority of Americans are shocked when they see the way in which the timber harvest activities have been carried out.
These people are hired by the United States government to utilize and safeguard resources that belong to the American people for all generations. And I see people literally copping out on their responsibility to protect the American resources.
Anybody in the back of an envelope could have figured out we were not, you know, cutting our forests sustainably. It's real obvious to those of us inside the agency who do the planning that it's not sustainable. We're running out of timber.
Wood is the number one raw material in this country from that we make things out of, wood and paper products. Just think about trying to live one day in your life without using wood or paper products. And we would really be scrambling, trying to improvise. You and I living here in Washington, D.C., or wherever in the cities, would really be up the creek without a paddle in some very basic things that it takes for you and I to survive without the products and the benefits that we get out of these rural communities. They are doing us a favor, and I think the American people ought to be appreciative of these natural resource products that we use every day in our life.
Come on. You know, first, let's put it in perspective and realize that the national forests only provide about 14 or 15% of all of the wood that's produced in the United States. It's a very small percentage. Most of the productive lands are private lands.
Weyerhaeuser, the great tree growing company, has stated openly that they can grow all the timber this nation needs on one half of the nation's timberlands. One half is a lot less than is owned privately. So on less than the total private lands, we can grow all the timber this nation needs.
If we wanted to make a social choice in the United States and say no more cutting on national forests, we could do that, and here's how. One of the things we could do is have a fairly simple recycling conservation strategy. It would include increasing our recycling of post-consumer paper products from what is now 29% to what Japan does, which is 50%. It would include increasing the efficiency of our mills, which means we would cut more wood per log. It would mean reducing the amount of disposable paper packaging that we literally take to the landfill. Those simple things would allow us in the United States to reduce the amount of trees we cut by 50% and not affect the supply.
I've got a winner in you. Swing this girl in my manager. A love I can hold on to. I've got a winner in you.
Well, we worry a lot about these communities that the national forests surround. Basically, the backbone of their economy is the natural resources. There are some opportunities in tourism and outdoor recreation, but that doesn't substitute for taking the timber or the grazing or the mining away from them.
Well, this mill here, Stoltz-Connor Lumber Company, employs about, currently on a single shift, about 75 people. And we get our timber primarily from national forest land, and so we're federal timber dependent.
You have no control over the situation right now. You just got that feeling that you don't. It seems like it's out of your hands. You like to get all the information, all the facts for people to make really good judgments, but it just don't seem to be working all that well. I don't have that much faith in the system.
As humbling as this job is, we make our living at it, along with the cabinetry. You know, we're proud of what we do. It's hard work, it's a tough job. The slash contracting or any of the woods work is. But you know, we're providing a service, not only for today, but for Aaron, for the future. You know, hopefully someday him or his children will be out here harvesting this again.
These communities have got to count on their natural resources for their long-term economic viability.
There's chicken and egg problem there. The Forest Service helps create the dependent communities. So it's not something that just always was there. Starting in the late 50s, early 60s, the Forest Service massively increased the level of harvest, encouraged new mills to be built, and created, in a very real sense, created dependent communities, dependent on a level of harvest they should have known, if they didn't know, they should have known was not sustainable.
Sustainability, that's the key. The forest can spare a limited number of trees for harvest each year. If that natural limit is respected, there will be trees and jobs indefinitely. Most of the national forests aren't being managed sustainably. At the current rate of cutting, old growth forests and the jobs that depend on them will be gone in 20 years. With the end in sight, communities like the one in the Bitterroot Valley are falling deeper into conflict.
You know, the timber corporations aren't very interested in jobs. They're interested in their bottom line. I'd also like to say it's easier to find a new job than it is to find another white stallion area.
There are a fair number of people around here who see that there's a big problem with the clear cutting. Even some loggers realize that things are going to have to change. But when the mills shut down this fall, they blamed it on the environmentalists.
The preservationists feel that preservation and wilderness are the only two things.
The society we live in today is dependent on our natural resources. You know, it's just like everybody goes down and a car comes from the car lot. And the beef comes out of the beef section. The 2x4 comes from the building supply store. All those things come from people like us.
What we have is the most important thing, and that's people, yeah. Families.
Right. We're saying stay out, period.
United we stand.
No compromise. Yeah.
Divided we fall.
Yeah. The issue has become both horribly polarized and horribly bitter. And I'm saddened by the fact that we, I like to use the word as neighbors, can't work toward a solution, realizing that we have contending philosophies. But the fact is that we are cutting beyond the sustained yield of not only timber, but water and wildlife and recreation and jobs.
We're doing the reforestation job on the national forest, and by and large, the private landowners are doing a fairly good job of reforestation. So it's not a mining operation if you decide to cut a tree and replace it with small trees to grow into a future forest.
The forests are a renewable resource. A tree is planted or a seedling comes up, it grows. It gets old, and it is either harvested or either the wind blows it down, or it burns, or it dies of old age, or it is harvested as a resource used by this society.
A forest is not a renewable resource in less than 500 years of the same climate that formed it. When you timber that, you destroy it. You destroy that forest. And what you get back are trees, not the old growth forest. You never get it back. And of course, as you destroy the old growth, you destroy habitat for many of our treasured animals. You destroy that wonderful sponge that controls the movement of moisture down to the stream throughout the year. You destroy the shade that protects the snow from melting in the summer. And you end up mostly with a tree farm.
A tree farm is like a cornfield. All the trees are virtually identical, the same species, the same age. Gone is the diversity of life that once existed here. Gone is the uniqueness of the virgin forest. Under Forest Service management, this stand will be cut again when the trees are between 80 and 120 years old. They will be approximately the size of a telephone pole. This was once an ancient forest. It has become a crop waiting for harvest.
Not only is it not logical, but it's not legal on public lands. All of our enabling legislation says that we maintain diversity and that we maintain the forest ecosystem. This is not a forest ecosystem. It's a tree plantation. Now, if you want to talk about some place do we want to have tree plantations, perhaps at low elevation, flat ground, deep agricultural soils, on private land, sure, we may want to have tree plantations. Not on steep slopes, thin soils, public lands.
Last year, we made about $600 million profit on the national forest from selling timber. Now, that's looking at all the national forests. Now, there are many, many national forests that do not make money.
100 national forests nationwide out of the 120-plus forests that cut timber lose money. What that means is that the cost of preparing the sales, the cost of building the roads, the cost of paying all those people to prepare those timber sales are much greater than the revenue that the forest gets when it sells those trees.
We manage the lands almost exclusively for one commercial commodity, timber. Even though it's a commercial commodity, they lose money. Hand over fist doing it. So they behave in an unbusinesslike way, producing a commercial commodity on which they lose money while damaging everything else that's important that's associated with the forest. It's a total loss situation, completely irrational from a social perspective.
They have written down the cost of the goods sold, claimed that it was worth nothing to you. I don't think that's the case. If you and I owned that forest, we'd be charging a lot of money before we sold that land. But the Forest Service has marked it down to zero. As well, they have discounted to zero all of the benefits that are lost. Once you had recreational opportunities in that land, now you don't. They say that cost you nothing to lose them. I think most of us, if we got involved in that or looked at it, would disagree.
We're subsidizing the cutting down of our national forests. It's at least $300 million a year that we lose cutting down our national forests.
And who pays for that?
The American public pays for that. It comes out of the taxpayers' pocket. In the last 20 years or so, timber has gotten 35 to 40% of the budget. Fish, wildlife, recreation, watershed, all have received about 2 to 3% of the budget. Incredibly skewed. So by any stretch of the imagination, by any measure you want to use, it's been heavily skewed toward timber cutting and road building.
There's been pressure on the Forest Service for 20 years to clean up its act and change the emphasis. And to most observers, timber still dominates. And so one has to ask, what's the source of the obsession? What's the source of this driving, almost unstoppable commitment to seeing all forested lands as a timber supply?
The problem began with the housing boom that followed World War II. In order to meet the new demand for wood, private timber companies were allowed to start cutting in the national forests. It was a great deal for the companies because their operations were being subsidized by taxpayer dollars. They pushed for higher and higher harvest levels, and the cut rose steadily throughout the 60s, 70s, and 80s until it was far beyond what the forest could sustain. The Forest Service could have stopped the overcutting of our public lands, but over the years, a bond had formed between them and the timber industry, a bond based on mutual growth and profit. Timber cutting has helped the Forest Service to build up their own bureaucracy. Their budget has grown in direct proportion to how many trees they offer up for sale.
Congress has set things up so that the more roaded, clear-cut land the Forest Service invests in, the larger their local budget is. The incentive system rewards the Forest Service for engaging in the most environmentally destructive and the economically most costly forms of behavior.
I'm the timber management assistant on the district, and it's my primary job to try to locate and find the areas where we can harvest timber, you know, to meet the targets that we get assigned. And I appreciate the value of looking across something like this, too. I probably like the outdoors and hunting and looking at wildlife as much as anyone, but just, you know, it's kind of a difficult thing to do.
It's a hard balance to find, and that's right. So we do the best we can.
The Forest Service is under a lot of pressure to keep cutting timber because it's very profitable for timber industry to cut old-growth trees. They're mining biological capital. That old-growth timber is a commodity that will never be seen again. It's very valuable, and we basically give it away at subsidized rates. through timber industry's pressure on Congress, Congress's pressure on the Forest Service to keep cutting.
I'm here today with a heavy heart, a heart that's in shock at what's happening in the national forests of this country. I'm extremely disappointed that what I feel as political pressures I have dealt with over the last few years in my region have now apparently resulted in the decision to remove me from this region.
John Luma was the head forester of the Northern Region. He was the only wildlife biologist in such a senior position. Muma didn't cut as many trees as his timber target called for, because he didn't want to break environmental laws. The Forest Service chief responded by giving him a choice: desk job or retirement.
So it appears to me, when faced with a choice, you could either get the cutout and violate environmental laws, or you could follow the laws and pay with your career. And that's why you're here in this uncomfortable room today.
It certainly appears that way.
Of the Forest Service, the most conservative group of people are the managers, the supervisors. You know, they're God-fearing, flag-waving, hard-working Americans. And you know what they've told us? By the hundreds? That the Forest Service is not obeying the law.
Have you ever told the chief that you'd have to break the law to achieve your assigned timber targets?
Yes, I have.
You have?
Yes, I have.
Can you tell us something about that?
Well, my targets were never adjusted. I might answer that way.
I'm the one that decided to transfer John Muma, and I did that based on my own size up of the job that needed to be done and looking at my 60 senior executives, which I have the flexibility to move around to make sure I've got the strongest team on the field. And I do that periodically, and that's what this situation was.
Could you identify those who brought the pressure upon you?
Specifically?
Yes.
Well, I would say certainly members of the delegations in both Idaho and Montana. You want me to be more specific?
I would like you to be more specific.
Senator Burns from Montana, Congressman Ron Marlaney, Senator Larry Craig.
Never did I ever tell John Muma on he should raise his ASQs or do anything in that forest. What I did tell John Muma, however, was this: if the forest plan is not working, amend it.
I don't consider that political pressure. No one has ever said to me, get the cut out or else. I doubt that that was ever said to John Muma, but somebody could have. I didn't say it.
I do love my job, love my career, and I love the national forest. If that directed reassignment is not changed, if I'm not allowed to continue my work that I think has been extraordinarily good, then I'll retire from the Forest Service. Thank you.
The national forests are not the private preserve of timber companies. And when we see them being pillaged for short-term profit at the expense of the long-term public interest, then I think the appropriate response is to feel outrage and to hold the political leaders who order this abuse accountable for it.
In my view, some of the political pressure that's being brought to bear upon the national forests of this land is not much different than what took place with the savings and loan scandal. I could have taken the reassignment, but you see, I would have become just like an ostrich, sticking its head in the sand, tucking my tail, and gone on. And the things that had influenced the activities here that I experienced would have been carried on to my successor. And the same kinds of things I feel are occurring around the nation now. The timber supplies have got to go down and reach a sustainable level. And the only way that can exist is if the American public raises up in arms and gets concerned enough about the management of these lands that they go back and visit with their respective members of Congress. It's a national interest that we're talking about, and it's future generations that we're talking about.
in our new ways of managing the forest, we're trying to do it more like nature did it. And under what we call our new perspectives program of trying to look at the forest as an ecosystem, not just look at the trees, but look at the forest and manage the forest as an ecosystem, we're getting away from that sort of thing and trying to manage more of a natural forest, but at the same time, get some wood products out of it.
It just makes sense now to look at it as ecosystems, and that's new perspectives from my standpoint. When you do look at options other than clear cutting for harvesting activities, and when you start to look at leaving trees for vertical diversity, for wildlife, and for visual quality, it all really fits together very well.
The words are great, but I don't see any actual on-the-ground changes, at least not in any large scale.
At this point, New Perspectives is a public relations gimmick.
They said that what they had now was something called even age management. And of course, the conversation got going. I said, I was on the council at the time, and I said, wait a minute now, what's even age management? And they said, well, clear cuts. I said, well, what's the difference? Well, we've changed the name. And I think that's something that you have to look at, especially with federal agencies. They don't change the policy, they just change the name they call it. And I think that the American people should feel just a little insulted as to what possibly people think their intelligence level is.
In the national forests, there are 50 million acres of unprotected roadless lands that are up for grabs right now. And unless Congress designates these areas wilderness under the Wilderness Act of 1964, these wild lands will be gone tomorrow.
Only a fifth of the national forests are permanently protected from development in designated wilderness areas. Most of our last virgin forests are unprotected. They stand in places called roadless areas. Once a road is bulldozed into one of these areas, it can never again be considered for wilderness protection. Current Forest Service plans call for new roads to be built at the rate of 10,000 miles per year.
Here in the Bitterroot, we're very concerned about this road that's recently been punched into the White Stallion roadless area by the Forest Service. And as most people know, once the road is punched in there, the clear cutters are soon to follow. And the Forest Service, of course, wants to extend that road deep into the heart of the roadless area, forever disqualifying it from being protected as wilderness, and the White Stallion area will be no longer.
There are already 360,000 miles of roads winding through the national forests. That's enough to take you to the moon and halfway back again.
You got your hair on nature walk.
Well, it is a nature walk. I think Western man has a habit, maybe a way of life, of separating himself from what we see around us. Looking at the natural existence for what value is it to him materially? Materially, what can I get out of this? But I think if man would stop to realize that he's not separate from the earth or the natural existence, it's part of him and he's part of it. And it doesn't really need him, but he definitely needs it.
Thank you.
When we arrived on this continent, we saw before us what seemed like an endless wilderness, an inexhaustible supply of raw material put there for us to use. The legend of Paul Bunyan helped create the illusion that we could go on cutting virgin forests forever. Today, we face the reality behind that illusion. The loggers have run into the Pacific. The wilderness is almost gone. Howie and many others like him are realizing that the value of our virgin forests goes way beyond what we saw in Paul Bunyan's day. Instead of an endless supply of 2x4s, we now see reservoirs of biological diversity which may be crucial for our survival. Instead of a harsh wilderness to be tamed, we now see one of the last places to experience our deep and spiritual connection with the earth. Biologically, spiritually, and even economically, these forests are worth far more standing than cut.
The U.S. Forest Service's Southeast Experimental Research Station in Athens, Georgia, 2 years ago, determined by estimating that there were $122 billion worth of benefits from recreation and wildlife from our national forests. On the other hand, if they cut down the national forests, as they are, they only generated $13 billion worth of benefits for our general economy. Now, I'll take $122 billion to let the forests live any day.
That serves the interests sometimes of the Forest Service to pit loggers against environmentalists. And in fact, the loggers and the environmentalists are the ones that live here, and we're the ones that have a lot in common.
You know, we've become aware that if there's going to be a solution to the problem, that we are going to be it. The people are going to be it. It's not the big corporations, and they have absolutely no credibility. It's the people. It's us.
In 90% of the cases, I think people in the conservation community and the woods workers are talking the same need and the same language. They need to find ways to talk and work together. And one of the woods workers made a comment that I thought was profound. He said, better 20 jobs for 200 years than 200 jobs for 20 years. To me, in a woods worker's language, that's sustained yield logging. That is what all of us are about. Because when you do that, you are not impacting these other forest values to the point that everybody loses. So again, find that common ground, work together, and I do believe the solutions are there. It isn't necessarily going to be the big corporate timber industry and the conservationists. It may have to be the workers and the conservationists, but it can get done.
These treasures are just like a savings account in a bank. You don't keep dipping into them at the expense of future generations. You've got to maintain those savings accounts, and that's what some of this is about, that conservation crossroads that we're at. It's very significant. So we got to have the leadership that stands up and says, whoa, wait a minute, what's happened isn't right. We've got to start taking a longer range view of the management of these public lands.
The reason I quit the Forest Service is so I could work full-time with a group that I started about 2 years ago, which is the Association of Forest Service Employees for Environmental Ethics. And they represent a new breed of government employees in the Forest Service that are going to try to make these kind of changes that we know we need to make from inside the agency. And that's why we've grown so quickly, because there are a lot of people in the agency, in the Forest Service, that want to see that changed. We want to see the Forest Service go back to its original roots of being a conservation leader and upholding the public trust.
Theodore Roosevelt said, In the past, we have admitted the right of the individual to injure the future of the Republic for price and profit. The time has come for a change. As a people, we have the right and the duty to protect ourselves and our children from wasteful development of our national resources. The fate of the national forests is in our hands. We can pass them on to future generations or exploit them for short-term profit. The choice is ours.